Hello, everybody. My name is Svetlin Nakov. I'm a technical trainer and inspiration manager at the Software University, where we teach people programming and we produce software in engineers in very big amounts, thousands, maybe 10,000 someday. So today I will talk about the MapReduce framework and Apache Hadoop, an implementation of MapReduce and many other computational models that allow big data computations, that allows to process terabytes, petabytes, exabytes of data in a distributed way, a way where you can build a cluster of, for example, 10,000 machines, which work together to make something for you. And it's Java-driven by design, but could be used with other languages and tools. I will talk about how it works, what is MapReduce as a computational paradigm, as a process, as a concept, how it works, and how to write mappers, how to write reducers, how they work together to achieve the distributed work, how the framework works with these mappers and reducers, and of course, we'll have some code, we'll have some examples, some web demos, etc., etc., etc. So let's start with this thing. It's all about big data. I know at this conference everyone talks about data, because it's Oracle conference. And my understanding about big data from the developer's perspective is to process very large data sets. It's about processing data which you cannot load in a traditional database. For example, I have a friend who works in Facebook, and he told me, I want to use MySQL or Oracle, but it does not do the job because we have hundreds of millions of users, even billions, and no database can do the job. This is the big data, the real big data. So the scenarios in which developers want to use Hadoop or similar frameworks are several. The first is when the traditional database just can't do the job because you have you need 100 machines just to store your data. When the data is very big, it doesn't work. And the second thing is that when you want a big amount of data to be processed very fast. I have a friend of mine who takes 300 machines in the cloud in Amazon. He has a script which brings them, provisions them. He runs a cluster of Hadoop. He processes something for half an hour and then shut down and remove these machines. So this is very interesting model. If you have to process a big amount of data very, very in small amount of time, you just provision a lots of machines, put them work together, distribute the work between these machines, and something which will be processed several days or a week on a traditional computer can be solved in half an hour or something like this. Inclusively to crack passwords, of course, but it's expensive. Yes, you can crack Wi-Fi passwords and mine for Bitcoins with this infrastructure. It will be not very good from the money perspective. So big data is to process very large data. Sometimes it's stored in files, sometimes it's stored in distributed databases like HBase, Hive, Cassandra, and many, many, many others. I think every big cloud provider like Amazon have their own solutions, have their own Hadoop infrastructures. Microsoft canceled their project, which was competitor to Hadoop, and they just made Hadoop work well on Windows environment. And often we want to do some analysis, some processing of this data. So the components are distributed databases, distributed processing frameworks like Hadoop, there are some others, and distributed models like MapReduce, there are some others. Distributed file system, this is something very powerful. To have to combine, for example, 200 machines and to copy a file on the distributed file system, and it reaches all these machines automatically, but the data is not duplicated too much. The data lives in some of the clusters. This is, I will show you HDFS. You just copy one file, it's copied on two or three machines in the cluster, and you have the hard disk space, which is nearly the sum of the hard disks of all the cluster. And when you access some file, it comes through the network to the processing node, which needs this file. So this is how big data works. This is the story of Hadoop, of course. This is not the only way. But for example, if you want to process 1 exabyte of some kind of data, for example, some sensors, Internet of Things, they watch something, and you have very, 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 very big amount of data. Of course, you don't store all of this in a single file. You put this in chunks in some directory and access it through a distributed file system. So let's talk about the map reduce. This image very well explains how it works. This is a computational paradigm, a way to organize your computing process in order for it to be easily distributable, easily to employ a large cluster of few hundreds or thousands machines to work together and to use their power at the max. So let me try to make this bigger. Wow, this doesn't work. Huh. Okay. The idea is that we have a lot of data, and this data is stored in some chunks. For example, I have 10,000 files, each of 1 gigabyte, small files, or even smaller, and these chunks need to be processed. For example, to count how many times something appears in some text, or for example, to analyze, to make something which is done by SQL in the traditional databases, to make some query, for example. But you cannot store this in database because it's very, very large, exabytes, for example. So we have nodes called mappers. These mappers are nodes, are processing units, which are given a chunk of this data, and they classify it by some key. For example, if we have data which is files from sales report, and it's written, we have 300 beers sold in Ruse, 500 rakia sold in Haskovo, etc., etc., etc. We can, the mapper could split the data into towns. So they produce as an output several chunks of data, key value pairs. I will explain this better, and we'll show you, of course, some source code in Java. But the idea is that we take data, and this data, the mappers distribute it into groups. These groups are by some, for example, town. So if we talk about database, I assume all of you know SQL. It's something like group by. You group by the data by some key, for example, by town or by year or by something else, and you split this into chunks. Later, this data will be automatically sorted, and it will be put to the so-called reducers. So reducers work on chunks of the same type. For example, for chunks of data, which is for Ruse, this is one reducer. Different reducers works for Plovdiv, different works for Haskell, etc., etc., etc. And they can combine and solve something, make some computation. It very depends on the computation time. Sometimes you have dependency, so you cannot directly, for example, sum the cells per town. This is easy. But sometimes you need something more complicated, for example, implement neural network, which is a little bit more complex, but it's modern in modern AI frameworks and computations. So the MapReduce is a distributed processing framework. It's a concept, computational model, which works with huge data sets. We talk about terabytes. And please don't use this for less than few gigabytes because it's inefficient. It's something like use rockets to fight the some animal, some cat with a rocket. It's not the right tool for you. So it works in large clusters. The idea is to have not one, two, five machines, but hundreds or thousands. And it relies on already done and well developed infrastructures like Apache Hadoop, for example, or MongoDB cluster. MongoDB also supports MapReduce. It's through the JavaScript, you know, MongoDB is a non-structured database of the so-called NoSQL database, and it just stores pieces of data, which is JSON, and you can apply JavaScript functions, mappers, and reducers, and it, if you have a large cluster, it will do the job for you. So most of these frameworks rely on some kind of distributed file system or distributed database. Because if you have a cluster of many machines to do some work, you need to have this data accessible from all nodes from the cluster, okay? But the idea to have all the data in single node is impossible. For example, if we have 100 machines and 5 exabytes of data, it will be chunks of it, it will be split among this cluster. So you need some kind of distribution, either distributed file system, which is HDFS, very powerful thing. You can use it in your applications even without Hadoop. Just copy files and they are replicated where they need it. And it's a Linux-based file system. You can use the file API, for example, open file, read, write, etc. And it works, it just works. And you work on your node, but some of the other nodes could read the data and it's automatically distributed among this the file system. So the framework takes care of all the scheduling, which nodes, what portion of this will process, what happens, things like monitoring, failover, what happens if some node crashes or the network stops or something happens, it will reschedule, it will choose another, a live node, and will move the data, etc. So there is no single point of failure. If some node crashes or stops for some reason or hangs, the framework will continue to find another node and send the same data to process it. So it's reliable, it's automatic, and if you want to implement this yourself, you will write a lot of code to manage these things, like what happens if some dumb node dies, what happens with the data which is sent to it, etc. Is this transactional, etc., etc., etc. It's a big many of these problems. So how MapReduce works? The framework takes the input data. For example, you have 10,000 files in the distributed file system, and it takes the first file and reads, for example, 10 megabytes of it, and just sends this data to your mappers. The mappers map, and also I can say these are groupers. They group the data by some key. So they produce key value pairs. For example, if you have a sales report, sales about, for example, 3 rakias in Ruse, 5 vodkas in Pleven, you distribute by town name or town ID, and you put town Pleven and say, for example, 5 bottles rakia. Next, Haskovo, 5 bottles vodka, etc., etc., etc. And the idea is that these groups are processed together. If you need some data together, you need to map it to the same key. Why? For example, we want to sum the sales for some town. We want to know how many are my sales in Plovdiv, how many are in Sofia, how many are in some other town. In order to sum the sales for Plovdiv, I need to have it together, or they should come one after another. So the mappers will map by town because we sum by town. For example, if we want to sum by year, we will map by years. This is some kind of grouping. sometimes you don't have natural grouping. For example, you just want to download 1 billion URL addresses and do something with the text at these addresses. There is no natural mapper, so you can just do the work in the mappers. Because, for example, if you have 1 billion records or chunks of data, and you have 300 machines, the MapReduce framework, the Hadoop, will call the first mapper and will run 300 in the same time and will send the first 300 rows. The next will be sent together. So the Hadoop will keep the maximum load possible on this cluster. So if you have some billions of data, it will be processed 300 by one. These 300 nodes will work together. And when some of them finishes, the Hadoop will send other data. And this is something like portions. For example, if you have a pipe and we have 1 billion liters water, it will put the most possible through this pipe. And when some space is in the pipe, it will put more and more work until everything is processed. So how the reducers works? The reducers finally aggregate the results for each keys and produce the final outputs. So the reducers will take the data for Plovdiv, then some other reducer will take the data for Haskovo, the other will take the data for Veliko Trnovo, and etc., etc., etc. But the data is given by the key produced by the mapper. So the mapper first splits the processing into groups, and later the reducers process each of these groups. So if your mapper is incorrect and always puts all the work on the same output key, everything will be done by just one producer and this will be slow. For example, if you have 1 gigabyte file and all the data inside are only for Plovdiv, all the data is about Plovdiv, and if you split by town, if you map by town, everything will be mapped to the same node, and it will be produced by a single reducer. So if you have 300 nodes, only one of them will work. So it's important to map the data in groups which are good, which are some natural splits, for example, by year or by town or by region or by something which has a lot of chunks, more than 300. If you have 300 nodes, and if you have only 20 towns, this will be inefficient. So you might need to split it by different criteria. Or just split them to random key. If the data are independent, you can split the data, the input key, to the same output key. Okay, I'll talk about the keys a bit later and you will see the code. So the mappers distribute the data into key value. For example, Plovdiv 10 level, Sofia 20 level, Varna 30 level, and these are many chunks. Then this data is sorted automatically by Hadoop and it's passed to the reducers. And we have one reducer for Sofia, one for Plovdiv, etc. If we have more towns than reducers, they will follow some queuing. For example, first Plovdiv, when the Plovdiv is finished on the same node, will be given Sliven or other town. So the concept is that the framework sends you some pieces of input key and value. So what's the idea here? For example, they told you, take this file. It is file Plovdiv data June 2016. It will give some key. Or if you have a single file, it will give you as a key the file offset. The position of your currently Hadoop could work line by line. This is very typical. You have one line for processing, and this is a single this is a single key value. And the key will be the offset in the binary file of this line number, and the value will be the content of this line. This is configurable, so you can change what is your piece of data, the granularity. And you write this map function. And the map function maps the key and value. For example, they put Plovdiv and as a key, and as a value, put some incomes for Plovdiv. Or if you compute the incomes and the expenses for each town, you can put in the value some object which holds several things about Plovdiv. And you want to do some aggregations by town. Later, the framework combines this data and produces a key and list of value. It's not exactly a list, it's a stream. Because if you have a large amount of data, you want to not to have gigabytes of data loaded into memory. You just, Hadoop tells you, this is one record, processes. This is another processes. This is another process. So you have these mappers and reducers, which are functions called many times. Billions number of times, depends on the data, of course, but if you have billions input records, these functions will be called very, very a lot of times. So the mappers group the input chunks into key value pairs. This is the main concept. For example, splits document by document ID and some piece of data into, for example, words and count. This is the hello world for Hadoop is word counting. We have 1 terabyte, for example, the text, and we want to count how many times each word appears in this text. For example, Sophie appears 1,000 times in this document. I will show you now this. So these are the main processes. Mapper, you write it. Reducer, this is a function you write. You can leave it, of course, empty or nearly empty to do nothing inside. And combine, sorting, combining, clustering, everything about this is done by the framework automatically. So you write just processing the mappers and reducers. So let's take one example. This will be my first example, and I will show you Java code. We have a very large set of documents. For example, 200 terabytes of documents, Word files or text files or some kind of data. And we want to count how many times each word appears inside. For example, to see that Sophia appears 1,000 times in these documents. Okay, so the input is a set of documents. It's a key and content. The key, for example, could be the file name, and the content could be the content of document. If the document is very large, it will be split, and the key will be the offset in the files, for example. There are many, many ways to split the input data into some processable chunks. So the mappers, what they will do, they will extract the words from the past input data and will produce some pairs of kind word comma count. This means that the key will be the word, for example, Sophia, and the count will be how many times Sophia appears in the current document. But we have many documents. And if the document is large, this will say, for example, Sophia 25, the next document, Sophia 0, the next document, Sophia 100, Sophia 5000. This will be the mapper. Plovdiv 200, Ruse 2000. You can think about this about something like very, very, very large text file with two columns. Key, value, key, value, key, value, key, value. But very, very, very large. It's not a file, it's a stream because it's processed, it's stored somewhere in the file system, it's processed somewhere in the cluster, etc., etc., etc. And what the reducer will do in our case, it will be given, the framework will give to the reducer the combination of word and sequence or list or stream of counts. It will say Sophia and 20, 30, 40, 0, 20, 40, all of the values produced by the mappers, but for Sofia. Another call to the reducer function will be, for example, Plovdiv and the numbers for Plovdiv. Pleven and the numbers for Pleven. This is how it works, and I'll show you a live example because I want to code, not just to talk, and to show you that it's not very complex. So how the mapper works, this is a map function. In Hadoop, it's a Java code. In Hadoop, it takes object offset. This is the ID of the document, or the offset, just a number. For example, the offset, the place in the file where the this chunk starts. For example, 0. The first call will be position 0. The next call will be position 10,000, for example. The doc text is the text of the current chunk. For example, it takes one or few lines from a text file, or it could take some documents. I give you an example for Word documents. This could be something like a Word document, and you will need to parse it to do something. And this is where Hadoop will work better, because if you have documents of this, of different types, for example, text files, images, PDFs, words, you will need a lot of processing to extract the text from it. And this will be done in parallel by all the nodes in the cluster. If you have only one machine, this will be very, very slow. So the mapper could do some heavy work. One processing, one piece of this data could take minutes, not few seconds or milliseconds, depends on the problem. For example, this mapper could download some file from internet and do something, some processing with it, and later it produces as output is content.write, the key value pair. It says Plovdiv 1, for example. It for each word produces a number, currently 1, because we count the words one by one. We can count, for example, if the document contains the word 50 times, this will produce this word and one value 50 times, which is not the most efficient way, but it works, okay? You can just count how many times and do here the amount T, which is the how many times certain word, but you need to make more complex computation. So you can test which will be faster, to have a very big amount of small computations or smaller amount of bigger computations. Because to count how many in certain file, how many times each word occurs, this could be implemented, for example, by some dictionary or hash table. You need to have knowledge about data structures to work efficiently with this. But this is very, very simple. You just find some word, pleven, and you produce pleven one. The next word is, for example, hello, one. The next word is, for example, Rusi, one. And this will be stored. Later, the reducer will take as a key this word, for example, Rusi, and will have a sequence of counts, sequence of numbers. It's iterable. You know, iterators, this is something which you can say, next, 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 give me next, 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 until finish. It's some kind of enumerator, or we can think of it about something like a stream, a sequence of something, but this is a sequence. So that's the code we write. We split, we take, extract the words from the chunk, from the current document, which is passed to the mapper. And for each word, we produce the word, comma, one. The word is the key and the output is one. And later in the reducer, we take the keyword, for example, Ruse or Plovdiv or hello, and a list of numbers. It's just a list of numbers. And it's some, because we write in Java, we need to do things like count.get or things like new text by word. It's not string, but it's the interface iText, which is the class text, etc., etc., etc. And this is intritable one, it's not just one. But if you write in some scriptable language like JavaScript, you will just place string and number, because there is automatic type conversion, etc. So let's see this in the real world scenario. Let's see this. I have one console. In my current folder, I have this example, and I'll show you what I do. No, it's not this. It's here. Okay. This is my code. I compile this word count program. The word count program is this Java class. This is the full source code, not only the code snippet that I show you. There are some special things here. We make this intritable and text, this object, only once, because this method will be called many times. Think about few billions times, this will be called. So if you create a new object, if we say new intritable, this will be slower than to create one object and use it 1 billion times, okay? This is anti-pattern for good code, for high quality code. To move the object outside of the place where you use it. But we need to do this. Think about this code. It will be called many times. So to split with regular expression could also be not the right way, because regular expressions are not fast, you know? It will be easier to, for each character by character, if you see the separator, to you have discovered the word. But for simplicity, this is my code. And this is the other class. You put this in a class which extends mapper of objects, text, writable, etc. This is your input. It could not be text, but some other class, for example, Word document or PDF document or something else. This is the input key, this is the output key, and this is the type of the output. This is intritable, but it could be some structure which holds several fields, for example, price, lowest price, higher price, date, or something else. And this is the reducer. It is another class. And these are some configuration things which says, okay, please use this mapper, this combiner, this reducer, etc. So I compile this. How I compile it? It is just Java code. I say, please make use this class path, which are the Hadoop libraries, and I say, please compile wordcount.java and create a jar file. If we run this, it will make this jar file. And later, I call this like this. First, I delete the input directory, then I make in the Hadoop file system, I say make directory input, but this is not a traditional directory, this is a directory or folder in the cluster. So if I have 300 nodes, currently I have only one on my machine, but if I have a large cluster of Hadoop nodes, this will make on the entire distributed file system this. And if I put these files, I put a few files, for example, currently these three files, will be put on the cluster. Okay, I will do this line by line. The first is please compile. I compiled, and now I have the jar. Later, I go here. Okay, I'll need to go back. I'll not run the entire script, but we'll run it step by step to explain you what happens. And later I say Hadoop file system and make dir input. And these commands are very similar to Linux commands. For example, you have cat, ls. Do you know these command line commands in Unix? So I make input. And if you see, this is the input folder on my cluster. It will be made also in the other clusters. It's not exactly like this because it's on demand. If nobody needs this folder, it will not be transferred to the other clusters. It's on demand. But you may think of it that you create one folder and it's replicated in 300 nodes in the same time currently, or a bit later if it needs times. Later, I put the file in the Hadoop cluster, in the Hadoop distributed file system. I say Hadoop file system, put these files. So what happens here? The files are here and their checksum is inside. It's some kind of CRC and these are the files. But these are the internal representation of the file system. Usually you don't want to get inside because it's internals. And later I say, Hadoop, please run this jar over my cluster and run this class. The input data, take it from the input directory, which could hold one on tens of thousands files, exabytes of files. Note that my hard disk is only, for example, 500 gigabytes. But I can upload in the cluster file system very more times more data than my hard disk because it's distributed. So I say, please process these input files and put the input in the output directory. So this is the actual work of Hadoop. Now it will run for each line. This is some statistics. It says, I read this amount of bytes, I produced this amount of bytes, I have 11 input records, I map them to 66 records, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So, my work was, this file was called many times. This function, this mapper, was called many, many times. The first time it was for this line, another call for this line, another call for this line. For this line, it produced one key I with value 1, another key M with value 1, another key N with value 1. At the reducer, what happens? My reducer get the, for example, the first word, which could be, for example, this. It was called from this one, not one, but a list of all these occurrences. So it's a different computational model. You will never do this if you write a normal program, okay? To split the data in some chunks and later combine them. Why? Because we want to run this on cluster. And finally, we should read the results. LS, it's Hadoop, FS, LS, EL, output. See, this is, what happens? No, there is no LL. LS, this is like in Linux, you know, LS common. Type. And I can also say cat output slash asterisk. No, it's not. Sorry. Cat file system cat. And this is my output. So this word example happens 12 number of times. This is demo is not as impressive as it should be because I don't have first 10 exabytes of input and I don't have cluster of 300 machines to because it will be really better example and it will be expensive. Okay, I can hire this in the cloud, but it will cost some money. So yes, and Hadoop is usually run in the cloud. Because easier to set up. You just say to Amazon, please make me a Hadoop cluster. Click next and you have it. How many nodes? 300. Okay, it's low. 10,000, please. And your bank account will be nice. Will look nice, but they can provide it with you. So this was my first Hello World example in Hadoop, to have some input files and to count how many times each word appears. My second example is more complex. It's a report. I'll show you the report. It's CSV or a sequence of CSV files. CSV, you can open it with Excel. Just sales report, okay? Data. We are at the Oracle conference. Everyone should work with data here. So there are some things like street address, city, and price. And we want to solve the following problem: to find all cities which have sales with price range from 100,000 to 200,000. This is something like this query. Okay? If you speak SQL, this is, I want to perform this in Hadoop. HS select, city, some the prices for this city, for example, all the prices for Plovdiv, from sales group by city, and also I have where, some where filter, between 100,000 and 200,000. Okay? So, I want to solve this problem. The concept will be something like this. I have CSV data, but think about very big data. 1 exabyte of very, very, not one hard disk, but one room with hard disks, one data center of hard disk holding my data. Very big data. The Hadoop will split it into chunks. For example, if I have 3 mappers, only 3 nodes, it will be split into 3 sequences of rows, of text lines. By default, Hadoop works with text lines. 1 chunk of data is 1 line in a text file. You can modify this, but this is the default out-of-the-box behavior. So if I have 3 nodes, or 300, this will be 300, okay? And they put some of the records on the first, on the second, or on the third. There is no... You cannot know which data at which node will be processed. And the output is what? Town, price. Another town, price. Town, price. The mappers will produce town and price, town and price, town and price, and will perform this filtering for the price range, and will output the town and price. And this will be sorted automatically by Hadoop and will be arranged into groups. For example, all the data about Sacramento will be passed to the first reducer. The other will be to the second reducer, etc. And these reducers, they will reduce the data and they will, in my case, they will sum. So it's very easy to implement in MapReduce things like that, where you have grouping, because it naturally splits the data. If you don't have grouping, you can group manually. For example, if I want to sum all the data, I can split it into regions, or into years, or into the hash code of the town name. I can split it by some key, and finally, the reducers will combine it. This is my code. My code says, please read the input CSV line. I take 1 line from this CSV file, 1 line in the Excel file. Okay? And I split it by comma because it is CSV, comma separated value. This is the natural format. I will show you with some text editor. This is CSV, comma separated value. I split by this, and I take the ninth column, because it holds the price, and the first column, field of 1, holds the city. I make the filtering, I check the price. If the price is within the required range, I write this city, for example, Pleven, and 200 cells. Plovdiv, 500. Sofia, 3,000. And it will duplicate Sofia many times. If I have 1,000 lines in the Excel for Sofia, it will produce 1,000 for Sofia. Later, the reducer will be done after the equal keys are grouped, and it will say Sofia and the list of all values produced by the mappers for Sofia. And I just want to sum these lines, okay? Plovdiv and a list of values for Plovdiv. Pleven, a list of values for Pleven. This is how it works. And you can notice that this, at the first glance, does not cover all computational logic you can use, okay? And yes, it's true, it does not cover, but it's about how good are you in inventing a concept how to use this to process your data. It is the more harder work to change your way of thinking, to think about mappers or splitting the input information into pieces, how to split it in a good way, in large enough groups, which are independently processable. For example, if I want to do something with Sofia and Plovdiv in the same time, I cannot split by town, okay? For example, if I want to combine Sofia with Plovdiv, if I split by town, once the reducer will be called for Sofia and another reducer will be called for Plovdiv and then work independently, how to mix the data for Sofia and Plovdiv. It's not possible. What is the solution? You can make another map and reducer, which takes as an input these sums by town and make another aggregation, for example, by region or by country. But this, so you can use this several times to make some more complex job. And okay, let me show you the code. It's really the same. So I will explain it a little bit shorter. How it maps, first it checks whether this is the first chunk. If it is the first chunk, it will be the header, because CSV has a header. This is the header one. I skip it. And in all the other lines, I just read the line and split it and just say city, price. I have these fields, the key and the value for the output of the mapper as external fields, because I don't want to have new. But this is not very fast. You can do it better, but it works well enough. And this is my reducer. It's similar, like we already seen. And this is some configuration things. What is my script that runs this process? It is something like this. Please compile it, create input folder, put all the CSV files. It could be one or two or five CSV files or 10,000s of CSV files in the distributed file system, run the script, and finally cat the output. I will run it directly. Just run. Hadoop is the slowest thing. It's currently running. If you write in Java, you are familiar with this kind of logs, log4j, maybe, behind the scenes. And the output is this. It's not correct to open it with Notepad this way. This is something like open your database with text editor, not with select. But it works, of course. And this is, oh, no, it's not this. These are my results. This town, this is the sum. This town, this is the sum. This town, this is the sum. It could also, what was the name? Real estate. If I write it like this. Usually you use scripts. Some people prefer Python instead of Java because the code is a little bit simpler. You don't have these transitions, castings, wrapping your int, to wrap int into int writable. But Hadoop could work with files. So you can write executable and say, Hadoop, please execute this exe file, executable file. So you can write in any language. There is no problem to write in, for example, Turbo Pascal or some other language. If it could make exe, it could take an input file, process it, produce another file, and this is passed to the framework. So this is how it works. So it was my second and final demo. And I want to say a few things in addition, because I know you catch the idea. And few things about Hadoop. Hadoop is open source software. It's sponsored by IBM, by maybe Oracle, I'm not sure, and many contributors. And it has the HDFS. You can just install and use it. HDFS is something very, very good. It's a virtual file system which is split among many nodes, and you can store more data than your hard disk.
Question? Can I use it as a regular file system?
Yes. It is a file system. It supports the file API. For example, you can say, give me all folders, give me all files, set access control, for example. This file has, Hadoop, FS, LS, for example, output. See what? This is. Oh, what happens? Hadoop, FS. Ah, yeah. Something like this. So you have read, write. It's a copy of Linux file system. This is the owner of the. Of my file, so it has the security.
Can I use it as a replication file system?
Yes, you can use it. Yes. You can use HDFS without Hadoop, just as a file storage. It's a distributed file storage. And for example, I put some file here from my laptop. If I say ls on another laptop in the cluster, it will first call, please give me the latest version, something like Dropbox, for example, or and if you say, please open this file, if this file is not locally available, it will be transferred through the network automatically. This is the concept. It's very powerful, so you can use it. Hadoop has MapReduce framework, which was the main in my talk. And there are many things which use Hadoop as a framework, but provide higher abstraction. For example, HBase is a distributed database. It has things like tables, add record, find, things like that. Hive is something very interesting. It's SQL-like query language for large data sets. So you don't need to write mappers, reducers, etc. You just write queries like this. Of course, not the entire SQL is supported, but something like this. And there are many other projects. You can see them on the website. Where is my Hadoop? Do we have internet? Yes, we have. And these are the projects. Avro, Cassandra, HivePig, Spark, etc. Most people don't use Hadoop directly, but use it through something higher, because if you want a large database, but database-like database, which could hold exabytes of data, you can use Hive or some of the other projects. If you just need to make some calculation over a big data set, you can write in Java and use the traditional Hadoop. So it's supported in the most players. For example, Facebook uses it heavily, because they have a lot of data, really. You can imagine how many data have Facebooks, and they work everything. So they keep redundant three copies, always, because one is the primary, one is the secondary, and one is, there was some reason for three, because this helps the failover, and helps many things. It works the file system by chunks of 64 megabytes of some kinds of blocks. See here, we have things like part 0. If the file is larger, it will have part 1, part 2, part etc. This is for all the files. And you have MapReduce API, and you have additional libraries which use Hadoop to make something more complex. And you can benefit from this. So The Hadoop works in a cluster, so it has a data nodes, it has some coordinator node which knows what happens in the cluster. Of course, it has second copy, because if this hangs, the second will be used. Traditional failover system to avoid crashes or something, because if you have 10,000 of nodes, some of them sooner or later will fail. Of course, you could be sure.
Do we have special requirements for the main node? Hardware?
No, this works in any hardware. I run this in Windows, which is not typically. I needed to compile some libraries. If you are interested, I could show you. But you can download the binaries. No, it works just on hardware, but have specific things for certain operating system, because it's reading the files at low level. To be fast, it reads and stores the files at low level in special thing. If I need to use Hadoop, I will prefer ready-to-use solution, for example, from Amazon, because I don't need to set up these things, to configure files. I could make it not in the best way, for example, not give enough memory or caching or something like this. It's better to use, but it could cost higher, of course. If you purchase 100 machines and do it yourself, you'll have money for the administrator. So it provides traditional Linux commands like cat, make directory, copy file, copy from local is copy local file to the distributed file system. Things like put file, which upload down something like upload and download. LS cat, get is something like download a file from the cluster into my hard disk. Currently, it's not very interesting because I have only one node and it's in my hard disk. But usually Hadoop is somewhere in the cloud, and you just upload some files and say, please process them. You wait for 20 minutes, for example, drink some coffee, and say, please download the results. Something like this is traditional things. And this, of course, could be automated, because most people have some kind of scripts, and they just click them or schedule them once daily to do this work. So the shell commands I already showed you. And MapReduce is implemented everywhere in the biggest clusters. For example, Amazon have EMR, they have HD Insight, Google in the cloud, they have Elastic MapReduce. This is a MapReduce Hadoop-based framework, which is run and managed by Amazon. Also, you could use the Google Cloud, and it supports Hadoop, of course, and the biggest players support it. It's the industry standard. I already told you that Microsoft had a similar project and they canceled it. They said, okay, we will use Java and Hadoop. Because they don't want to use Java. It's not normal. Windows, Microsoft, and Java. Ah, shit happens. But currently, when Satya is CEO of Microsoft and they support Linux and everything, they changed the strategy and canceled their Hadoop alternative project. So all the biggest players use it by some or other way. This is how it works, but it's all what I already explained. You have the files on your distributed file system. The mappers take these files. Later, Hadoop partition this, sorts the data after by key, for example, by towns, group them, and you get Plovdiv, all of the data for Plovdiv, Varna, all the data of Varna. And this is map to reducer. If you have less reducers than needed, you have a queue. One reducer will process Plovdiv, then Pleven, then another town, etc. If you have less data than reducers, you have one chunk per reducer. So it depends how you split your work, and the output is also in the HDFS. So if you want to install it, you'll find either in the cloud, it's already provisioned, but could cost a lot, especially if you bring a large cluster with very powerful machines and very big number of nodes. And you can use a sandbox. For example, Cloudera have Quick Start VM. You just download the VM and run it. I use it in Windows currently. I installed this in Windows, and you need to compile some libraries currently in Windows. I need to have WinUtils and Hadoop DLL. These are needed because of the HDFS to be able to use the low-level IO, which is not possible in Java, just in Java without special things. Things like monitoring the files, what happens at low level, etc., etc., etc. So this is my talk, and I'm open for questions. Yes.
You mentioned that the processing is done in a stream-based way.
Yes.
Does some kind of back pressure, for example, in reactive APIs like RX, reactive extension, and reactor for Spring, they use reactive back pressure, reactive streams, and by functional composition, you can specify, like in HTML, you
okay.
can actively specify what transformations you need for your data and make it distributable to different nodes. Are there some kind of APIs you can recommend? I know about Spring Big Data, Spring XD, which uses
Reactor. I didn't use this. I used only out of the box solution, which works on text files because it's easier. And I'm not sure how it works at low level, but basically it takes some data, put it through the mappers or reducers, and when it's processed, takes more data, and it's done in the same time, because during the processing, the network also works to give. I'm not sure that you have reactive, but I mentioned some project about Hadoop with Spring. Hadoop. There was something about Spring for Hadoop, which is some kind of integration, some dependency injections, etc. And Hadoop with reactive, I'm not sure. Huh, maybe Spark. Spark is something, yeah. I think there is something, but I didn't use it.
Stream your data naturally.
Yes, yes. I think they do it already, but I didn't use this. Other questions?
What about this Apache Spark? Is it similar to Hadoop?
Spark is something based on Hadoop. And but it's something additional engine, and it says runs one faster than Hadoop in memory, run. I didn't use Spark. Spark runs on Hadoop, but I know that it's based on Hadoop, but makes things better. Community. They don't say exactly what they are doing, or only that they are faster. But why cluster computing? Yes, Spark is another framework which does something similar, like Hadoop. But Hadoop is the older, the more industry and standard. Okay, RDD API. I don't have experience with Spark, but they use HDFS. It's Python and Java. Usually the big data are always Python is the primary language and Java is the secondary, and the others are. But it's similar, but it has higher level APIs in Spark. See, parallelize, dot filter, dot make, which is something to write MapReduce in easier way. Because
exactly, yeah. Exactly. Functional reactive composition.
Okay. Maybe this is the thing you mentioned. I know in .NET there are similar things, but they are different. They use the so-called lingual language integrated query, and they say, please do this in parallel, but it's among the cores in your machine.
Is it possible to integrate with Hadoop?
Yes, Microsoft have worked heavily to do this. They support it in Azure. They say their project is HD Insight, something like this, which is Hadoop Spark and R and things like that. In Azure, so they support MapReduce, PIC for scripting, Hive for SQL processing, HBase with NoSQL streaming, in-memory Spark is for something like Hadoop, but it does this answers what is Spark. It does everything in memory, which works well if you have a lot of memory and a lot of SEPU cores, it will work very well. But if you cannot use only one machine because your data is too big, you need to use the others. It's an ecosystem, it's not a single product. When people say Hadoop, they mean this family of products, and they use what, depending on their needs, some combination of this. For example, I have a friend in Facebook who use this Hive for some project inside, and they say that they have very large data sets, really large. Things like that, not one computer, it's a data center. You have a question? Do we have time? But they say they do this in memory. Like in memory databases are faster because they don't use I/O for the hard disk. This is something like this. I think this is fast, good, but it's limited. It's for specific scenarios where all your data could fit or chunks of it could fit in the memory. Other questions?
I see some sort of machine learning.
Yes. Yeah. It's machine learning is always related to clusters of data, etc., because the data is large. For example, to learn machine translation, you need to have some few gigabytes of text and few other gigabytes of output text, for example, in German and in English. And the machine learning algorithms try to match this sentence is mapped to this. Later, they say this phrase is mapped to this phrase with this probability. And this is a very heavy, these are very heavy computations. I have built myself with industry tools, freely open source tools, simple translation engine. And when you say train this, you wait for one night to be processed. So AI will need these things. And usually they are in the cloud. I believe the modern machines and robotics use very large cloud. For example, I've read some robot which can move things, but it's not autonomous. It has very high speed connection, a cloud in the cloud, 1,000 machines think what to do, and the robot acts. Yeah, this is how some of the robotics works now. Okay, so we don't have more time. Thank you, and I'm around. We can talk.